Good evening. There's theory, and then there's theory. And then there's theory acted out, and theory acted on. And then there are buildings pulled from theory, and theory pulled from buildings. And for some of us, the idea that theory and buildings are one is an oxymoron. Taming materials is just one aspect of the equation. What about gravity and functionality, and dare I say, program? And are these aspects natural enemies of theory? Don't we all like to think of theory as an immaculate, even virginal, mostly unattainable driver of architecture? And then there is theory that explodes into vast expanses of materials, fiberglass, concrete, whatever, that proclaims a unity of form and principle, matter, and its opposite. Reiser says he can't think of any great architecture that is essentially programmatic in its origin. Umemoto says, if you are attentive to it, matter and program can be reconciled. Can they both be right? I can imagine the debate when Jesse and Nanako work together. Jesse Reiser and Nanako Umemoto have been debating their propositions, first from a garage studio, if such thing exists, in Dobbs Ferry, way up the Hudson from Manhattan. Then at Columbia, Princeton. And I have to congratulate Jesse because he's just been promoted to be to professor at Princeton. And always in this steady stream of project which hewed ever closer to the realization of their vision. Their scheme for the IB Museum and the West Side Convergence were warms up for idealistic projects, such as the collaboration with Greg Lynn and Ben Van Berkel that galvanized the post-9/11 debate, which plunged them full tilt into a flurry of invited international competition. And I think this is where they found themselves crossing swords with others like Norman Foster and Jeannie Gang, but I think that's an easy battle to win, and the roster of past masters. But then again, it wasn't easy. But it did look like it was a lot of fun. That's because Jesse and Nanako are makers as well as thinkers. Recreation for Jesse is staying up late, putting the finishing touches on the model of an antique airplane, bridging the gap between digital and analog worlds, and bringing the love of craft that first took him to Cranbrook, where architecture was taught as an art and has brought them to a unique place. Or places, because besides publishing a very academic book on essay on design, the Atlas of Novel Tectonics, they are on the threshold of making that leap from the academy to the construction of major projects around the world. It is a great pleasure to have the opportunity to hear about their work here at SCI-Arc, because I think there is a special resonance between our school and the intense love of architecture, which we all share. As Jesse has been a regular presence here on our thesis juries and recently just taught a studio last summer, I hope that a little of SCI-Arc DNA rubs off him. A lot of his, I know, has already rubbed off on us. Please give a warm welcome to Jesse.
Thank you, Ming, for the introduction. No, I guess I've been visiting SCI-Arc for the past at least 15 years. Actually, the first visit was coming off the Yokohama Port Terminal competition, and I was so tired. Had to give a lecture, found myself in the bathroom just before the talk, and the grid of the tiles suddenly induced a kind of hallucination. I started seeing floaters moving exactly and systematically 45 degrees to the tile grid. So that was my first. Every time I come here, there's always something like that happens. And I wasn't disappointed today either, but I won't talk about that. But it's true, I think, you know, having gone to Cooper Union and Cranbrook, there really is a kind of natural affinity between our background and the work you know, that's going on here at SCI-Arc. And in a way, a lot of the academic experience I've had has been a kind of corrective or kind of positive friction against that craft background, how to redirect it, how to think in a way beyond craft. So I want to talk today about four projects, really three and one I'll just touch on. And all of them are happening really outside of the United States. Our practice is a very peculiar one. We have hardly any work in the States, and so most of it comes by way of competitions, in fact, all of it. And so I wanted to talk a little bit about that, and also to begin to open up some speculations related to, you know, allied fields first. One of the things that I found really compelling were the kind of parallelisms between cooking and architecture. And of course, that was something that I, you know, opened up a little bit in the Atlas of Novel Tectonics. But I could see quite clearly that the kind of material culture of food really does resonate in some amazing ways with that of architecture. And that goes from really kind of traditional regional styles to a kind of international style, the neoclassical tradition, which really formed French cooking, and then even to mass-produced food and the places where that kind of food was consumed, Levittown, and even, you know, the more kind of idiosyncratic directions, like the space food sticks and the futuristic, not futurist, buildings. So one can find these parallels, I think, and they are, in a sense, very much embedded in a way of understanding architecture as a material practice, but also as a material practice that intersects a kind of semiotic. Some of those are quite representational, and others go into a kind of sign system that is more like a symptom. And so we can see the kind of move from fusion cooking and nouvelle cuisine and the minimalism that's present in both to the neo-regional of the slow food movement, and you can see this thatch house as a kind of example of that. And then finally, to directions that are current today, which we feel a great affinity for, the kind of molecular cooking, where in a sense the tradition is questioned at a fundamental level. Received notions of food culture are brought up against an almost scientific use of materials and the production of new kinds of sensory effects that kind of flow out of it. So this is just a kind of a side comment, but it just seemed to me a really interesting set of parallelisms that I think parallel the direction and development of our own work. So I want to talk about the first project, our O14 Tower in Dubai. And again, it was really a project that was done almost entirely remotely. We worked out of New York. Our design engineer is a Cuban, stone from Santiago, so forth. And everyone converged on Dubai, which in and of itself is a kind of placeless place. We were first actually introduced to Dubai by way of a competition, and this is one of the early renderings, which was a kind of come-on to the competition, which we kind of coined as a circle of hell, a slice of hell. It was to design the kind of central iconic building for Business Bay, and all of this was designed as a master plan by the British firm Halcrow. But this is the reality of the site. So the central tower that we were supposed to design was supposed to be centered on that ragged red flag at the bottom of the image. It was really as close to tabula rasa as you can imagine. And the kind of cities that result are also, in a sense, really deterritorialized places. And I think one could argue that Dubai isn't so unique, that all of these kind of global kind of nascent cities share very similar characteristics. So how to operate in that context? One of the things that happened early on in the competition, we were up against Pritzker winners. This was Rem Koolhaas's Severe Prism, and he very cleverly basically wanted to anticipate what his competitors were doing. So you see the United Architects Tower, that was what he assumed we would do, and I guess there was some caricature of a Zaha and a Tom Main, and he wanted to contrast that against really another kind of modernism. And that, of course, you know, relates back to a very old technique. Mises' atom building is really a kind of prism, a crystalline prism delivered to the 19th century city. That was something we really didn't want to involve ourselves in. We wanted to try to work through some other way of dealing with the presence of the architecture in this, you know, strange new growing context, that it would neither kind of cleave to an older modernism nor to the sort of amplified versions of that modernism or postmodernism that you found in the skyline, in a way to pick up some of the traits that you find in molecular cooking, but bring that to the discipline of architecture, that in a way you could understand, and now architecture is involving itself in a kind of artificial nature. The other thing that was very important in the context of this commission that we were given beyond that competition was that the whole context for development was kind of changed from, say, the earliest towers, like in Chicago, where Colin Rowe quite clearly quotes the conditions of, imposed by the speculator really conditioned the type of architecture and the type of space, very utilitarian, kind of mercantile ethic. Ours assumed an extreme level of excess, that the building also had to be iconic, but then how do you do iconic now? How do you wrestle with that issue? So those were as much part of the hard requirements as the square footage. And then, of course, also the context itself of Dubai. This is an image of Sheikh Zayed Road. And you can see kind of one iconic building after another, and just behind it, a series of parking structures. And so you basically get a very active frontage on the main road, on Sheikh Zayed Road, and then just a continuous dead block behind. The other thing were in Business Bay, a whole litany of design codes that had to be followed. And basically those were formulated around a kind of historicist postmodern assumption about what urbanism should be. So a podium base with an active frontage was one, arcade. There also the requirement that a base building, which typically for economic reasons would contain parking, would be part of that ensemble. So we worked very closely with the developer and were able actually to subvert or to reinterpret a lot of those codes, and I think we were quite successful in kind of negotiating that kind of difficulty. So instead of the typical podium base, we super elevated the podium so it doesn't meet the ground, and we also began to think through the possibility of having multiple grounds working in the project. So not just movement in the front of the building on the ground, but also at an elevated level in the city. The other thing was how to deal with another form of arcade. And it took some time, and I'll describe the evolution, but ultimately we realized that the shell of the building itself, if kind of pulled away from the lobby, in effect becomes the arcade, and the retail space that they asked for could also be included in that in-between space. So as I mentioned earlier, the super elevating of the podium, actually even higher than the podium of Lever House, was something that we went after instead of blocking the ground plane, so that our building could serve as a kind of connector or gateway to the waterfront that the building was situated on from the back street. So we freed the ground plane, and then also were thinking through the possibility of extending yet another level across the complex. During this time, OMA actually were asked to redesign the master plan, kind of took it away for a short time from Hal Crow. And they suggested this kind of continuity, and we thought it was great. And it's still part of the project, although unfortunately ours is more or less a kind of utopian suggestion of what that continuity would be. The adjoining buildings, while they have podia at that height, essentially block that kind of movement on an upper level. But it's there as much as we could control it. And so we worked through all of those kinds of constraints, all of those codes, and we also were particularly concerned about how to deal with the aesthetic of the form making. And one of the things that I think has always been a part of our practice is not to really embrace wholeheartedly the computational or the digital aesthetic. that's always been a source of productive tension in the studio. And I show this just as a kind of aside. These are two gruppos that were designed, these are bicycle parts designed by the Italian company Campagnolo. On the left, it was a series done in the late 80s. It was a very interesting historical moment because the computer was just being introduced into industrial design, certainly of bicycle parts. And the company, the Italian company, which had been the leader of this kind of design for racing bicycles, suddenly found themselves under assault from Japanese companies that were making them cheaper and using all computerized design. So there were a group of designers, older designers, who weren't computer savvy, but they were asked to basically design as if the work were done by computer. And I actually contend that this work, to me, is far superior in terms of its aesthetic and its sophistication to the work on the right, which is in the same company where that's about 15 years later. It's all, of course, performance-based, computer-controlled design. But there's a net loss, I would say, in the aesthetic dimension. So we, in terms of our ethos, are much closer to the slide on the left, I would say. The other thing that I thought was a really important, really discovery in the process was that I suddenly found a kind of resonance with material that I had been reading 20 years ago, specifically Walter Benjamin's famous essay on the work of art in the age of mechanical reproduction. And I realized that things had changed to such an extent, and this is one example. You know, he talks about the notion of an original, and the mountain becomes an exemplary kind of example of something that produces what he calls the effect of a distance. It's original, it's rooted, it's something that is, in a sense, completely opposite from that which can be reproduced. And so I realized that what in effect was happening with the project, and when I saw it on the skyline, was this strange sense that the building couldn't exactly be placed in terms of its either its age or its origin. It was somewhere in between being natural, somewhere in between being artificial, and it really appeared more almost like looking at the moon come to Earth. And as one drives by it, it didn't really associate itself with the normative kind of stratified buildings, the curtain wall buildings on the skyline. Very peculiar. So all of this kind of talk of the Benjamin essay really came about as a result of seeing that effect. And I started to think through what we had been doing. Another thing that you know, clearly connected back was that this work, like many of us in the room, deal with iterative production. So in a sense, there's no original, which is very different from the older forms of production. And we're also not involved so much in trying to make this work assimilate to the context. And many times it's confused. People associate the work with a burqa or with traditional Arabic culture. But in fact, I would say our work is really far away from that. Woody Allen's Zelig figure is a kind of exemplar of the arch contextualist. He's a shapeshifter. He becomes anything he's close to. So if he gets close to the Zelig figure, gets close to an American Indian, he becomes an American Indian. If he gets close to a black jazz musician, he suddenly becomes black. This kind of work, we feel, is something to be avoided. Rather, the figure that we're really interested in is the Chauncey Gardner figure, who basically speaks very simply, almost dumbly, but then the work gets the meaning projected onto it, rather than it trying to kind of become part of the context. The context is read into it. So, yes, our work does involve itself at some level with the process of weaving. And it's interesting to note that, in a way, weaving as a kind of minor art cuts across many cultures. It is a kind of international structure. Although we didn't really look at traditional weaving at all, the origin for our work came from the basket weave of the Wellington bomber. But anyway, that structure seems to be a persistent one. Also, the connection to bone, or to Swiss cheese, or to effervescence, or even to historical models like the Melnikov house, were things that we didn't really bring intentionally to the project, but they're projected onto the project. And then there are consequences to that. I mean, the interior view of the Melnikov house then resonates, especially in this kind of crude, before everything is finished, this construction shot of the back of O14 with the staircase. It's almost like Rotwang's laboratory in Metropolis. And then, of course, there are other projections onto the building as well, like SpongeBob. So the building and the work we're doing, we try to keep as open as possible, not trying to overdetermine meaning in that sense. But the meaning just begins to collect. On a physical level, the project is actually quite a simple one. It's an exoskeleton tower. We went through some iterations where we had a more normative scheme, and I'll show that in a second. But ours is a 40 to 60 centimeter thick shell, which then surrounds a core, which is actually quite a lightweight structure. So most of the lateral forces and gravity forces are taken by this kind of wide stance shell. And then four levels of underground parking and a floating podium space, which then connects to the tower, the office tower, through bridges. But we arrived at that solution through a kind of roundabout process. The image on the right was our proposal for the competition that I mentioned earlier in the talk. It was for an 84-story mixed-use building that had, it was a kind of hybrid of a folded slab building, and the folded slab on the upper half of the building contained hotel and residential. And then that folded slab then split into a series of office towers that joined at a common sky lobby. So in a way, it was an advance, or it was our kind of development out of the work we had done with the United Architects. The organizer of the competition was really impressed with the project, though we didn't ultimately win. It was Zaha's project. And he asked us to design O14 as his first project as an independent developer. So he wanted to capture all of the formal kind of elaboration of the 84-story building in a 22-story building. And so you can see 16 odd iterations that attempt to do that, none of which worked. So he reached a kind of crisis point in the project. At that point, it was still more or less conventional building, column slab with curtain wall. And at that point, also, it was a mixed-use project. So the cruciform top would contain duplex apartments. And then as the cruciform basically expanded out, there was room for office space. There were tremendous difficulties in getting the geometry of a building at 22 stories to work in terms of the complexity of the curtain wall, and a whole other series of problems arose with the project. We basically shelved it and then went back to the drawing board again, excuse me, again, and then really rethought the possibility of doing or how to do a tower in this context. And we came to the idea of the exoskeleton. And at that point, the program became office only as well. And you know, going back to precedents, again, it's retrospective. The building is more or less an inversion of Frank Lloyd Wright's St. Mark's Tower, whereas the Wright building deals with a kind of central core, a trunk, and then a series of trays that cantilever off. Ours inverts that idea, takes what is a tight central core and expands it out to be a kind of drum-like shell, and then the floors basically hang from fairly delicate tongues from that, and then they're connected to a fairly lightweight structure in the core. So notionally, this is what happened. We went from a column and slab building, columns and structure get pulled to the outside, fuse, and then become this exoskeleton shell. And then there were issues, of course, on you know, how to make the connection between the shell, the office spaces inside, and then at this level, the podium. And we worked through a series of designs for the bridges that would connect these areas up. This is also a really interesting moment in the section where the 60-centimeter shell has to go to a 40-centimeter shell, so there's a continuous reveal, which you might be able to see, following along this margin. And that's the place where the shell changes thickness. So it's not a taper, but there's a kind of abrupt change, and it produces that detail. So a byproduct of separating the shell from the glazing and the window wall is that we were able to have a really clear kind of vertical space from top to bottom, and that allowed for a stack effect to occur. So it was, in a sense, a byproduct of another set of design issues that produced the so-called sustainable part of the project. Once we were told about it, of course, we capitalized on it and then reduced the scale of the tongues, but the design really didn't emerge from an interest in a passive solar system, but more or less developed out of its byproduct. So this diagram basically illustrates how that cooling works. And we were able to reduce cooling costs by about 30%. But this also brings up another issue, which I think is really important now, is the question of how we, as architects, deal with the issue of sustainability. One of the things that was really vexing me for a long time was whether the sustainable actually had to be manifest in the building or not. And I realized, you take two totally disparate architects, Bob Stern and Tom Main, both of whom, have LEED Platinum projects. So at the level of performance, it's quite independent of, whether the architecture is good or is bad. Is really I would say, almost no consequence at all. That's also a good thing, because at least, you know, one has a fair amount of design freedom in terms of how to design a building like that. It's obviously a responsibility, like health and safety at this point, to do buildings that are sustainable, but they don't have to really represent their sustainability. So it's not necessary to have green roofs or propellers or any of those things in the buildings. They could be done even as neoclassical projects if you wanted. So, on to the next. The other part of the project that was, of real interest was had to deal with a fairly simple form. We went from a more complex one in the earlier iteration of the steel and glass project to a very simple extruded envelope. And then the issue of how to kind of bring together a fairly monolithic extrusion with a highly featured kind of envelope. And so I kind of give this as an example. The pyramid of Cestius in Rome is really fascinating because it's really hard to tell how tall that building is, especially when you don't see any of the stone blocks. It could be either huge or tiny. It's actually much smaller than you think it is from a distance because of its kind of scaleless quality as a silhouette. And likewise, it's very hard to understand scale or even to it's the use of a feature that kind of defeats clear reading of scale allows for a more detailed understanding of how the building can be read. So one of the things that we experimented with in O14 was to deliberately make the connections between the floor heights and the diagrid out of phase, so that it would be very hard to tell how tall the building was. And that actually kind of came out as proof. This was a blog where people were trying to correlate window the openings with floor heights. And so the project went through a whole series of iterations and a series of demands, really, between kind of structural demand and also atmospheric demands, optical demands, in order to kind of work through to the final process. But basically, what we were trying to do through these series of iterations was to drive the main sort of forces down to a regular column grid at the base of the building, but not to clearly read how those force lines moved. So we're always trying to mitigate a clear pattern through changes in the localized pattern. And then this is an unrolled view of the facade, and all of those kind of horizontal lines, which are quite asymmetrical, are the connections back to the slab, the tongues. And so the effect of that building is really quite different from the kind of one point, the grid, which then ultimately becomes highly kind of perspectival, one point perspective. Here you have continuously changing expansion and contraction of the openings. And so kind of multiple perspectives at once. Almost a sense that the facade is kind of pulling or sucking you inward. And that resonated with something I had seen as a kid, the Yellow Submarine with the Sea of Holes, where it was very hard to kind of tell up and down, inside and out. So moving from those external effects, we started to speculate on what the effects of, say, a gridded office space are, is versus a very variable set of fenestrations on the space itself. And the gridded space of the office is actually, you know, conditioned on, you know, originally, of course, on not only filing paper and information and all of the kind of the bulk of how offices are organized, but also people. And so our speculation on this was that one could really change the way an office could be configured, that the functions or the uses can't be overdetermined, of course, in a spec office tower, but that people could arrange furniture in zones according to how much light or views they needed for the particular functions. And because you're no longer burdened with that much paper filing, the office itself becomes much more flexible. So within the office, too, you get a very different sense of horizon and a view. It's almost a kind of a set of staccato views, of disjointed views of horizon and sky rather than continuous pans of the landscape. And then pulling further back from the building, there was also a very curious set of transformations that occurred going from the kind of the first rendering of the project to construction, where the project actually becomes the most material and the most sort of tactile in that sense. And then finally in the finished project, where curiously you go back to almost the condition of a built rendering. And I think it also has to do with the, you know, the shift in the way these buildings are designed, that much of the craft doesn't happen on the building site, but it happens in the way that everything is set up in the architectural office to craft the geometry. So the molds, whatever you get, whatever you draw is what you actually get. There isn't a kind of gap in representation or a gap through craft on site. I think increasingly we're going to find projects that look like the renderings. The other thing that was of interest to us was the way in which we found a kind of dialogue between the material condition of the building and its effect. So there was a really interesting analysis done by Guy Nordenson's class at Princeton on Les Robertson's steel design for the World Trade Center. And it was really interesting. There were 13 different alloys and strengths of steel used in the Trade Center, all of them in the service of keeping the building relentlessly the same and similar in dimension. So they would, the various strengths would take up the loads but keep all the dimensions of the steel uniform. Our project, in a way, is part of that continuum, but on the kind of far opposite side. We were really trying to maximize heterogeneity in the facade. And so we really relied mainly on the redundancy of a diagrid system to be able to really handle, really be flexible in terms of what it could do, and to a lesser extent, not changes in strength as much as changes in density of the reinforcement around the facade. But it's part of one continuum, I would say. And so both are kind of tube structures, exoskeleton tubes, but they have, you know, really different effects. And I'm just going to touch on this. This is our proposal for the structure of the Shenzhen Airport. But quite literally, we carry certain of the interests that came out of O14 and tried to kind of push them to the next level. So one of the things that changed from O14 in terms of the use of a diagrid in concrete was to change the angle of the opening of the geometry. So the holes were no longer, you know, cut normal to the surface, but varied in terms of their angle to the surface. And so we thought that could be a fantastic way of developing the vaults for the airport, and a whole other set of flexibilities kind of flowed out of that, not only kind of varying the atmosphere in the space, but also being able to really calibrate the angle of view as you moved along the travelators in the space. So we find that rather than starting from scratch at each project, we try to bring the research that, or really the design developments or models that came from earlier projects, and try to reproject them in the new project. It was also a moment where we were thinking about revisiting the notion of how to use the column in the space, that instead of making a dematerialized high-tech or airport space where the column was almost to disappear, we were really interested in the kind of potential of the kind of plasticity of these massive columns and how they begin really to modulate space and direct movement. So back to O14, this is a kind of chunk of the waste mold, the formwork of foam that was broken out of the openings. And the building really rose, was kind of slipped up. It started with this matrix of rebar around the void forms and slowly slipped up to form the final castings. So this is a view from the roof before the final finishing. And I'll just go through some views of the project. This is that gap, that 1 meter gap between the window wall and the shell. This is the, actually, that was conditioned by the minimal amount of space to get a person in there to clean the windows. And we even lavished too much time on the design of a reception desk, which was kind of a steel shell based in part on the zigzag chair of Rietveld. Okay, I'll move on now to the Taipei Pop Music Center, which was the competition we won a little over about a year and a half ago. And here it was an invited competition. There was a demand from the government in Taiwan to really support their music industry. The music industry in Taiwan is one of the oldest in East Asia, and they really created to a great extent Asian pop. But they are now under threat from other countries like Korea and mainland China in terms of the support of their industry. So they want, for the first time, to bring all of their musical production into one center. This was the Taipei Pop Music Center was really a place not only to perform, but also to nurture and to roll out new pop groups. So the complex consists not only of an indoor and an outdoor performance space, but also an office tower given over to the music industry where the producers and the artists could interact in very close quarters and find the right scale of performance, whether it happens in a very intimate hall or out in outside where you have space for 14,000 people to watch a performance. But this is really not a place like in a stadium where you have room for 75,000 people. Like if U2 comes to Taiwan, they wouldn't go here. This was really much more about developing an internal venue for the Taiwanese pop music industry. And so one of the things that was really important here was to think of this not only as a center, but also as a big piece of urbanism, that it at once had to be connected to the city, but it also should be somewhat distinct from the city. And so we actually worked through a kind of mutation of a model, starting with the stadium, which is obviously there's one point of focus in the stadium, to the idea of a circus where you have multiple foci, and then the idea of taking that as an urban morphology, cutting off its ends and basically opening it up to the city. So finally, the idea was that we could hold events of various scales, and that this place would always be active because we could let the general public in to certain controlled points. So there would be kind of normal activity in the city while you'd also have different scaled events within circumscribed areas on the site. So this is the animation. It basically shows that idea. The cutting of the ends, the connections, the connection across to another site across the main road where we have the auditorium and the tower. The cube is a hall of fame, and it also carved out of its face is an audience seating for 450 people. And then finally, a robotic stage that I'll describe in a second. But another part of this project was that it had to function both as a venue that you physically could go to, but it also would be clearly a place that would be televised. It would be, it would have to be iconic to the extent that you would kind of see it and recognize it as being the center of Taiwanese pop immediately. So the thought, too, was that we didn't want to have a fixed icon like the Bob Costas model, which would be like Taipei 101, but more a kind of Madonna model where, Madonna is known as the one who is constantly changing. So that the media and even the physical configuration of the project would constantly change and shift. So this was kind of basically the main idea of how the space could be modified. This is a moving stage, the robotic stage. At the end, when it's placed at the end of the site, you can have a really large concert. Then the stage would actually fold, this robotic stage would fold. And when it parked at this station on the site, you could get a medium scale concert and so forth. And finally, when it's brought all the way to the cube, when they say it kisses the cube, you could have a very intimate performance and then really open the entire space up to public space. And so we thought through how users, various types of users would engage this site. And also went through the exercise of thinking through how many major concerts they would have outdoors. So roughly every 2 weeks you would have a major outside event, and then one could then kind of slot in a whole set of other kinds of uses over the kind of course of this two-week cycle, from red carpet events to green market, night market, Chinese market. All of those kinds of events would keep this venue constantly active and living, as opposed to a stadium, which basically is dead, between event times. And so here again is kind of reiteration of that idea of the changing configuration of the stage, the stage would fold like an origami, would actually get smaller as it moved towards the cube, and would also, of course, handle different scales of crowds. And so these are just, I won't go through all of these, but all of the possible permutations of how events could be staged on the site. This is a view of the outdoor amphitheater when there isn't an event. It's really more how it could be used in its park-like configuration. And then this is a view from within the seating of the cube. When the robot is kissing the cube, you could have a very small, intimate performance in really close proximity, probably more a kind of an acoustical performance as opposed to one that's amplified. And then this is a view from that cube down the entire length of the site. And so this is the detail section of a building which contains the functions of a museum and Hall of Fame. This is a bit hard to read, but this is a section through that elevated auditorium space, the outside auditorium for 450. And then it connects down to a podium that's completely occupied as well with various functions, even kind of street-like functions down below inside the podium, and then connect to the main hall, which houses up to 5,000 people inside, and then the tower, which is for the music industry, as I mentioned. And then just some other views of the robot, and then the robot engaging the cube. And some early experiments on how LEDs would be applied to the cube. It completely, constantly changed the identity of the cube. And then, we worked really through the idea of views and proximity to the cube, of really working through cones of vision. This section through the main hall basically, gives you a kind of clear idea of the proximity of the tower to the main space. So while it looks like an extension of the fly tower is actually down here. It's pretty minor. And it extends all the way up and has public spaces both here, restaurant here, and then another kind of public or semi-public space, really, one for the artists and for the industry in this space. And that then, the auditorium itself is configured to handle both pop concerts, but also they were hedging their bets, and it also has to be able to handle traveling theater, Broadway shows, etc. So it had to be really flexible enough to do all of those things. And this is again a view through from the atrium in the tower. And this gives you a sense of that, how we really figured the elevated ground, that the podium creates a really huge area of the city that's kind of generous enough to be a park, but it's also somewhat separated from the context. So you get a really interesting possibility of dealing with this notion of borrowed landscape, that the immediate context basically falls out of view, and then you get kind of framed distant mountains and no immediate context in view. There have been developments since we submitted the competition, and I'll just go through a couple of images. There were really kind of severe acoustical problems that were came out both in the new code and also because there are neighboring towers about to be built. So we're now working through a shed, basically, that will be kind of work both as an inside and an outside space for the 14,000 person venue. And so we're working now on a system of louvers for this shed that can be opened up and one can see the sky, and then the louvers can be closed down. It can become an acoustically sealed space only for the event itself. But the idea, too, is to keep the ends of the shed open, so you do get a sense of spatial continuity all the time when this just becomes a park space. It becomes a kind of covered zone in the park. We've also we're starting to kind of refine the development of the cube origami so that in its park configuration it actually merges with the geometry of the shell and then takes a few different configurations as it moves on the site on rails. So here's a film of harbor city, Kaohsiung. They expect, I think, increasingly unification with mainland China, and they are really encouraging the development of the cruise ship industry to connect with the mainland. So basically, the problem is to think through how to move from an industrial port to one that deals with keeps the industrial aspect of the port, but also can incorporate post-industrial and touristic uses. So again, there was a push for the icon, and again, we made a kind of plea not to deal with a fixed form of icon, but in this case, a more a dynamic icon that, in a sense, the form of this project would work almost like a machine part to direct the flows in and out of the project from ship to building to city. But one of the problems of the site in Kaohsiung is that it's very flat. It was developed using a very traditional 2D zoning models. So it was very difficult to deal with the demand for the creation of a public space, first of all, along the water's edge, the development of the terminal space, and also be able to have the industrial uses go on at the same time. So what we proposed was a kind of sandwich in section, having the industrial part of the harbor still work at grade. The terminal would notionally kind of slip in between that industrial layer, and then the public space would be on top. And so we kind of worked through the idea of kind of creating and extruding this model along the waterfront edge. So there was a planning aspect to the project where we would propose not only the kind of development immediately around the port terminal, but also for a larger development around that, and then also suggestions for how the whole edge might be configured. And so this idea of the raised public space was our solution for having those multiple functions happen simultaneously, but at the same time keep them quite distinct and separate from one another. So yeah, this map basically kind of indicates the idea that this elevated boardwalk structure and then various programs could plug into it, and it could be extruded all the way around the edge and undergo, you know, various changes according to the kind of programs that might happen there, whether they would emphasize the industrial part of it, the object building part of it, or the public space. Those would all vary depending upon the immediate needs on the site, but that kind of armature would be in place. And so this is from the land side of the project, the drop-off. And it was really important for us also to kind of use the building sectionally itself as a way of stepping and moving up the layers of the section. So while the building is seen as a series of kind of objects sitting on top of the podium from the water side, from the land side, they begin to descend down to the ground itself. And so also those kinds of intersections then become opportunities between building and boardwalk for specific kind of functions and uses to occur. So the building itself is understood as fairly simple, that there are kind of four major lobes to the building. The one on the right would contain the port functions and the port tower, and then three more, one for high speed kind of ferries, a ticketing kind of distribution volume, and then another kind of lobe for the cruise ships. And then space itself had to be joined. We worked heavily with the idea of a poche space, not a simple wall dividing the lobes, but actually creating spaces around each of the boundaries that would basically contain all the vertical transportation so that the spaces themselves could be kept quite open and clean. And then this gives you kind of clear view from the water side on top and then the land side at bottom, and how the section kind of cuts across the strata of the project. And then this end view really gives you a sense of the kinds of twists of the form and how they then negotiate all of the infrastructural paths. This view is more of the port terminal tower. Again, there's a port use, which is for the cruise ships and the high-speed ferries, and then there's also, this would be the place where the port authority would be located and where the whole port is basically directed. So people would also go there for bills of lading, and all kind of port business would happen in that tower as well. And then this, again, view from the boardwalk. So those connections to boardwalk and building allow for functions like restaurants to occur that allow you to basically look down into the space, but you're here in kind of a general public space, and you can look down at the more controlled spaces, but not really directly connect them. So it's like designing an airport in that sense, how to deal with the clean zones and the so-called dirty zones in the project, and how the two can be brought into very close proximity. And so another part of that was also the idea of distributing more flexible spaces around the project. That there was a call for flexible space, but our proposal, instead of centralizing that space, attempted to distribute those kind of multi-use spaces around the project. So while one part of the project might be in use periodically for the cruise ships, one could go to another flexible space while that was happening. Or when the cruise ships were not there, then one could swap out that space for a flexible space. So again, as I mentioned, we weren't interested in kind of producing a gridded space for the terminal, but rather kind of an evacuated, highly figured space that would direct views and movement, and that would also connect to the flows on the boardwalk. So it is configured very much like an airport, where you enter at an elevated level, you can go straight to the ships, and when disembarking, you go one level down for baggage pickup and out. But this simple space, this kind of diagram of the space, also allows you to see what will be happening farther up in the space. So if you have more time, you can dine, and you'll see that dining area, or you could even go up and onto the public boardwalk. And then this is just kind of a typical departure sequence from the terminal entry to ticketing to the final boarding lounge. And then the reverse movement, where again you move into the boarding lounge and then down to baggage claim and then to pickup. And so we've been really working through the development of the structure in that post-chaise space, and also how to fenestrate that space so light can be brought in not only to the post-chaise area, but it would also filter into the terminal itself. Another part of it as well is that the building, because of that push for its kind of iconic presence on the edge, that much of this kind of fenestration is used with artificial lighting at night, and that the building's striations would really become a prominent feature on the skyline. And then this is a typical view from the harbor approaching. And then I think we have the last film. Thank you.
Thank you.